I was told by the family this would probably be a small gathering. We proved them wrong, didn't we? I want to just take a moment and for on the family's behalf and tell you thank you for being here and honoring Larry Duncan and the family. Just thank you very much for being a part of this and supporting this beautiful family. Let me pray. Father, again, I come to you and on behalf of not just the family, but all the friends that are gathered here. Lord, it's never a fun time. It's always seems to be a serious time when we gather together like this. So Lord, I pray today, right now, that you would have your way in the hearts of everybody here. That through this, through what you've told me, through what you've been sharing amongst the conversations of the family and friends, that you would reveal something so spectacular this morning to the hearts of your people. Father, thank you. Have your way in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, there'll be a song.
Last night I had a crazy dream. Wish was granted just for me. It could be for anything. I didn't ask for money or a mansion in Malibu. I simply wished for one more day with you. One more day. Sunset, maybe I'd be satisfied. But then again, I know what it would do. Leave me wishing still for one more day with you.
Listen to every one of those songs this morning, and I don't know why y'all chose those. I'm telling you, they're tough. So. Larry Collins Duncan, devoted husband, loving father, and hardworking individual, passed away peacefully in his home in Shawboro, January the 19th, 2024. He was born on July the 22nd, 1945 in Shawboro, the son of the late John Paul Duncan and Idell White Duncan. Larry lived a fulfilling life. It was marked by dedication and service. And after proudly serving the U.S. Coast Guard, he embarked on various career paths, including being self-employed farmer and truck driver. He embraced each role with diligence and commitment, earning the respect of those around him. Larry was a man of strong values and unwavering love for his family. He shared 58 remarkable years of marriage with his loving wife, and together they navigated through life's joys and challenges and building a beautiful family filled with love and support. Larry will be deeply missed by his children, Dawn Marie Jones and Kevin and of Camden, and Roger Duncan and Sharon of Shawboro. And their lives have been enriched by the presence, and his memory will forever be cherished. In addition to his immediate family, Larry is survived by two brothers, James Duncan and Joyce of Shawboro, and Mike Duncan and Kathy of Elizabeth City, North Carolina. And their bonds and for brother is unbreakable and devoted and offers mutual support and strength. Larry was a proud grandfather of four grandchildren. Proud, I know what that feels like. Jessica and Justin, Alexis and Aaron, Justin and Megan and Madeline and Ryan. He adored them and took great delight in watching them grow up. Furthermore, Larry is blessed with four great-grandchildren, which I do not know of yet, but I will one day if the Lord tarries. Ava, Cheyenne, Abram, and Arlie Joe, who brought immense joy and laughter into his life. I can account to some of that because I've met them, those little great-grandchildren, and just spending a little bit of time with them the other night, they made me laugh. So I'm certain that they will, and I'm sure they made their parents mad, but it makes everybody else laugh. Amen? And I'm thankful that they're their children and not mine. So. Let's pause again for another song.
I could see, yeah.
You know, one of the greatest attributes and characteristics of our God, my Savior, is that of comfort and his willingness to give it to whomever ask him. And I'm so thankful that that is something that he has done. He is willing to comfort every one of us at any time and in any place and in any situation and any troubles that you and I may find ourselves in, as he has done for me so often. I could spend hours telling you of times that I spent on my knees crying and weeping over the things in this world that has caused me pain, and he has comforted me every time. And I want to offer that to you this morning. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians, it says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He is the Father of mercies and the God of all comforts, who comforts us in all our tribulations." But there's a reason for it. He said that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves were comforted by God. He said, "I comfort you, but not just for you to keep. I comfort you that you would be able to take that same comfort in times such as this and comfort others who find themselves in turmoil and situations of trouble and heartache." There's a passage of Scripture, and I want so bad to preach to you. I'm going to do my best not to, I promise. But I like to move when I preach, but I'm stationary because they won't give me a mic, so I can't move. There is a passage of Scripture that I hold so near and dear, and I've used so often in situations and times such as this, and I want to offer it to you. It's a passage of Scripture, if you hear nothing else I say this morning about the life and legacy of Larry Duncan, may you remember this one thing, and it's in the Scriptures. It's Philippians chapter 4, verses 8 and 9. If you can log that on the sticky side of your mind and go back at some point when you're hurting, if you'll just ask God to bring it back to your memory, Philippians chapter 4, verses 8 and 9, if you'll grant me the opportunity, I want to read it to you. Now listen, what it is in these two little pieces of Scripture is actually a recipe. It is a recipe like you were to go to your grandmother's cupboards and pull out from her recipe book that she holds near and dear, and nobody gives them to me, but they hold near and dear, and you can go to this recipe box and pull out the recipe for peace and experience in the presence of God anytime you're in trouble. I want to offer that to you. As I was preparing this message and what I would say, I just pray, God, show me what you want. And it pops out such as this. And listen, in Philippians chapter 4, I'm only going to give you two verses, which is rare for me. It says, "Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, those things that are pure and noble and just, whatever things are lovely and whatever things are of good report, if there's any virtue, and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things." He said, "The things which you've learned, which you've received, which you've heard, and which you've saw in me, these do." And listen very, very carefully. "The God of peace will be with you." He spells it out, and I want to share it with you how to break it down in Scripture so that through these difficult times, through these moments. Now see, this is difficult, but this isn't the most difficult time that this family will spend. The most difficult time will be when they're by themselves, when there's not a congregation of people and loved ones and friends to come around them. It'll be difficult for a family, any family, this one and you alike, to sit around a table and no longer set a plate for the one that's been there for so many years, or to exchange a gift, or have a laughing time or a reunion with this person. That is why it's so important that not just today, but in days to come, you can remember this recipe, if you will, spelled out in God's word for us. Like any good recipe that your grandmother may have, they tell you first the ingredients to prepare. There's something that you and I need to prepare for, something we need to find. And he spells it out very quickly. He says, "Get out the ingredients. Get these ingredients out." Here they are again, just to put them into your memory. He says, "Those things that are true, get them out. The things that are noble and lovely and good and praiseworthy." And I know the next question for anybody that would be reading these passages of Scripture and trying to understand what they're actually saying, you would be this. What are you saying, preacher? I don't know what they look like. Just like I would ask my wife, where is the frying pan? What does it look like? I know there's butter and I know there's margarine, but I can't tell you the difference, preacher. Amen. So all of these things, we can find the ingredients listed here for us. He says those things which are pure, and those things which are noble, those things that are praiseworthy. So once you know what to get, let's find them. Where are they at, Mama? Where are they at, preacher? How can I take, what are you talking about? We're going to pinpoint them right now very, very carefully. God's word is so good. Not are we told what to get. He says, here they are. Here's how you find them. Those things, listen to what he says. Those things you've learned, those things you've received and heard and saw in me. Go back to the cupboards of your heart. When you're looking and you're struggling and you're grieving, not only for Larry, not only for family members or friends or someone who has gone away to live somewhere else, he said, go back to the cupboard of your heart. Go back and look at the things that you've learned from this person. Listen to the things that you've received and heard and saw, and do these things. Now, allow me, if you will, some examples. Whenever I am asked, as a pastor, and I have been asked a lot lately to officiate funerals, it is not difficult for me if I know the person very, very well. But it is difficult when I don't know the person well. So what I do, and in this case, I know the family members, but I don't know Larry that well. Although I grew up as a crow flies, maybe 2 miles from them my whole life. I grew up on East Ridge Road. I mean, we were on the better side of town, Sligo. I mean, and they're in Scarborough. I know we're upper crust, and that's okay. But I didn't know Larry. I knew his face and what my daddy would tell me or things I've heard. So what I do in situations like this, I want to spend time before officiating with the family. So that's what I did the other night. And when I walk into a room, when I'm asked to do something, even if I'm not, so I'm going to give you the same precursor I give everybody else. Anything you say can and will be used against you in a sermon. So this is one reason why I come to sit with the family and talk. But a lot of what I do is listen. So I want to give you just a couple stories. I'll clean them up because they're not always given to me. As I can use them behind the pulpit. People forget that I am actually a pastor and not just a funeral service gentleman. I'm sorry, Alexis, but I'm going to use you. So, she told two stories. There was three actually told, but only two I feel that I can use. One was about Larry making coffee early in the morning. And that was Jessica. I believe Jessica was asleep. And Larry gets up to make coffee. And I make my coffee very much probably like you do. I put two little packets of sugar in there, and I pour black coffee, and I click the spoon just a little teeny bit, and I'm done. I do it every morning throughout a whole pot, again in the afternoon throughout a whole pot. I know how to do it, but apparently Larry doesn't. He'll put his sugar in there, cling, 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 cling. And he'll stir for 10 minutes until he woke Jessica up from sleeping. May I say this? The things that irritate you and frustrate you in the moment, God can use to bring laughter and joy in times of grief. That incident that I'm sure irritated Jessica to no end has become a commonplace story for others to hear. And you know what it does? It brings joy. Whereas at first it brought irritation and aggravation and sleeplessness, but now joy. The other story I heard, Alexis told me, now she's the one telling me all these stories because she's like her daddy and can't not talk. And she said she was in the living room and Larry and some friends were cooking oysters in the yard. And they came in for a beverage, of which kind I'm not going to say, but they came in because they were thirsty and their throats were parched, and they came in. And Alexis was sitting there and saw a blaze out in the yard. And she said, Granddaddy, there is a fire in the yard. He said, I know that we're cooking oysters. I don't know how y'all cook oysters in Scarborough, but Sligo don't do it this way. Just saying. So she says, no, the yard is on fire. No, we know there's a fire there, Alexis. We're cooking oysters as they continued to saturate their thirst. And after a moment, Alexis quit trying and just sit there because they'll learn. And somebody realized the yard is on fire. Just about to overtake a piece of equipment that's sitting in the yard, whether a tractor or a combine, I'm not sure. But they got it put out, and Alexis didn't help them. She tried. And that very incident, I'm sure, was frustrating to Alexis and others. But it has become a pastime of laughter, as you're doing here, because in your mind's eye, you can see this happening and transpiring. And that's what the Lord is saying. He says, here's the ingredients. Those things you saw, the things you heard, the noble things, the good things, the praiseworthy things. You take all these ingredients and you prepare them together when you're around friends. Talk about them. Talk about those times when the grass was on fire, when the coffee mug was irritating you, or the time when, I guess maybe I can say it, that Kevin was seeing Dawn early on in their relationship. Larry said, come on in. My house is your house. An hour later, he was telling him, get out of my house. I don't want you here. Talk about those things. Laugh about those things. And in the midst of when you are grieving, you will find yourself having joy over that which once caused you pain. Do you understand what he's saying here? I have four children of my own, three of which are girls. And there are two things that they don't like to do: to be reminded that they act like their mother or that they look like their father, especially the look like your father part as a young lady. But do you realize that when my wife and I and Linda and Larry came together, they bore children, and those two flesh became one. And they became one in Dawn, and they became one in Roger. In a part of each of them, or in Dawn and Roger and their grandchildren and great-grandchildren and so forth and so on. And you will begin to see attributes. Maybe it's body positions. Maybe it's little isms, little things that they act like, talk like, respond to. Whatever the case may be, make coffee like their grandfather. It's in those moments that your heart will find peace as you begin to resonate with the things that were given to you by Larry. These are ingredients. He says the things you've learned, you've received them or inherited them, the things you've heard, and some of those things you have seen, not only from him, but from your grandparents and your parents, from your friends, from your family. See, we're all made up. We're all have touched the lives of so many people. I was looking through the photograph book on the computer of Larry and his life, and I was kind of wanting to see it go as we played the songs. But as I was watching this, Larry has touched thousands of lives. Some good, and let's be honest, probably some not so good. We've all had those bad spots too. But God said, you can use it all to bring about comfort. And then there's the final ingredient. Not only do you pinpoint what they are and prepare what they are, and the final portion of what I wanted to tell you is you ponder these ingredients. Listen to what he says in the last part of verse 8. He says this. He says, if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on it. Meditate on it. That word meditate is an agricultural term in God's word, and it literally means to go over and over and over. I tell you, it's an agricultural term because that's what cattle do. That's what sheep do. Sheep do something called chewing the cud, and they will eat, and they will bring it back up, and they will taste it again. That's what the scripture says, that you will take these things that you've learned, the praiseworthy things, the good stories, the things you saw, the things you've received, and you will think, you will ponder them, you'll mix them all together in your mind, and you do it over and over. Now the good things, not the bad things, the good things, over and over and over again into your heart and in your minds, because he says, and in the things that you do, do these things, the good things, the good attributes of these things, do these things. It's okay to do the good things. And here's what he says in the last part of verse 9. He says, the peace of God will be with you. The peace and the presence of God literally will dwell with you. Now that is comfort. That is something that is black print, white paper, easy ingredients for all of us in any time of need. Do you know why you're here today? You say, well, of course, preacher, we're here to honor the life and legacy of Larry and to support the family members. Well, that's what you're doing. Truth of the matter is, you're here because of death. That's the hard fact and truth. We're here because death has brought us together this morning. And death has a way of keeping its appointments, not only with Larry and others who's gone on before us, but with you and with me. The Bible said it is appointed once unto man to die and then the judgment. These are hard truths, hard facts that we are faced with even this day. Death is a subject that they'd rather preachers not talk about. Oh, please don't talk about that, preacher. That's so ugly. We don't even say death anymore. We don't say die. We say pass away or went on beyond us. The truth of the matter is, we die. It's a mark of sin. And I would be amiss if and not doing what God has called me and put his anointing on my life to do, to not tell you the truth about death. Death is painful. And death has an appointment to keep with every one of us. But I also wouldn't be doing my job if I didn't offer you comfort in a way that you and I and anyone at any time can experience the peace of God and how to receive that type of peace into your life. And I'm going to give it to you very quickly, and then I'm going to be done, and I promise. For those of you who've ever heard me preach, you know that that's apt to change. But for now, that's my promise. 1 Corinthians 15 says it this way. He says, now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is there to be inherited, but you will not, and I will not, and nobody else will inherit it in flesh and blood. Nor does corruption inherit incorruption. Paul says, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep. But we shall be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed from the flesh into whatever God has in store for us. For this corruption must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. And then he says, so when this corruptible has put on the incorruptible, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written. This is written in the Old Testament. It says, death has swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, hell, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. And then I'm so thankful for this next passage. Here's what it says. But thanks be to God who gives us victory through the Lord Jesus Christ. I am so certain that among the men and women who are sitting here this very hour, some of you know Christ as your Savior, because I know you, and I've had an opportunity to pray with you, and you've received Christ. But I'd also know that doing this as long as I've done it, there's those sitting here today that you're thinking about it, but you've never received Christ. And he says, I want to offer you comfort. It's so simple. And I'm glad it's simple, because I'm a simple person. He says, anybody who calls on the name of the Lord Jesus and places their faith in him shall be saved. That's according to God's word. And it is very, very easy to say, difficult to do, that we take and place all of our trust in the Savior Jesus Christ. And it's something like this, that you would just ask Christ, say, Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I can't buy my way to heaven. I can't be all of the things that you've asked me to be, and I can't pay the penalty of the sin that I've committed. But you have. So with all that I am, I give all of me to all of you, and I'm asking you, Lord, to be my Savior right now. That, ladies and gentlemen, is salvation. Father, thank you. Lord, that I was a part of this. Your word tells us in the book of Luke that when you came to the city with all your people there, that as you approached that city, Lord, you began to weep out loud. And you said, oh, had you only known this day, especially this day, what was made for your peace. Lord, I pray that if there's a heart here who has received you, who today they've nailed it down and said, yeah, I trust you, Lord. I want that peace that passes all understanding. May they tell somebody about it. Lord, for the family, for those who are hurting, I'm asking you, Lord, with all of my heart that you would comfort them, that they would take these small little points, those traits that Larry left behind, those sayings, those actions, those words, the good actions, the good traits, and that we would meditate on those things, and that they would bring peace to our hearts through this time. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. At this time, there's a last song and then the honors. Amazing grace,
how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
three volleys that you just heard. It's a custom of the three volleys at a military funeral to be traced back to the European Dynasect Wars, where fighting was halted to remove the dead and the wounded from the fields of battle. Once the area had been clean of casualties, these three volleys were fired into the air as a signal to resume fighting. Not my idea of fun. Today, these three volleys, not a 21-gun salute, represents duty. And each one of these are engraved. Honor and country. The veteran has done his duty to his country, family, and the nation. He has served this nation beautifully, whether it's 2 years, 4 years, 26 years. He's still a veteran and a hero in our eyes. So please accept our condolences. I will give these to you at the same time, if I can get that today. And the VFW has presented a bag of shells for this salute.